Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Radio Right, How a Band of Broadcasters Took on the Federal Government and Built the Modern Conservative Movement, by Paul Matzko, narrated by Kyle Tait. 1. Introduction. Every hate-monger, radio preacher, and backwoods evangelist. During the 1960 Democratic presidential primaries, John F. Kennedy's campaign faced a significant hurdle in West Virginia. Kennedy had won several other primaries, but only in states with significant Catholic populations. Many Democratic Party strategists believed that Kennedy's Catholic faith posed an insuperable barrier to winning the White House, a theory that would be put to the test in West Virginia. If Kennedy proved that he could win in an overwhelmingly Protestant state like West Virginia, then he could win anywhere. The campaign poured resources into the state, buying ads with every major media outlet, and sending the president and his photogenic family on a whistle-stop tour. But Kennedy was still losing the state in the polls by a wide margin. The reason wasn't much of a secret, according to the campaign's internal pollster. He was a Catholic. A local campaign official located the source of the problem. If Kennedy lost, it would be because every hate-monger, radio preacher, and backwoods evangelist is being stirred up for an assault which will make 1928 look pale by comparison. That was a reference to the general election in 1928, when Democratic presidential candidate Al Smith, also a Catholic, had lost West Virginia in a nearly 20-point landslide, roughly the same margin of defeat that the polls were predicting for Kennedy 32 years later. As future Senator Ted Kennedy told his brother, the problem was not that ardent anti-Catholic religious extremists represented a particularly large block of votes, but that through their constant harassing technique, they would make John F. Kennedy's, JFK, candidacy a referendum on religion, and thus alienate modern Protestant voters otherwise sympathetic to the Democratic platform. Although the campaign did not specify who these radio preachers were, the radio preacher with the widest coverage in the state at the time was Carl McIntire, a fundamentalist minister based in New Jersey. He might not have been a West Virginian, but his radio program aired on three stations there during the 1960 primary, including a station that covered the two largest cities in the state. McIntire opposed Kennedy's candidacy and routinely raised the question of continued church-state separation to insinuate that if Kennedy were elected, he would give subsidies to Catholic parochial schools and take his foreign policy cues from the Vatican. That prospect alienated many Protestant voters in West Virginia. This was the power of radio broadcasting in 1960. From a relative handful of stations, right-wing broadcasters could reach thousands or even millions of listeners with their criticisms of Kennedy's faith and politics. Biographers covering Kennedy's 1960 campaign invariably note that he participated in the first televised presidential debates with a haggard-looking Richard Nixon. But what is less well-known is that he was the first presidential candidate forced to deal with the phenomenon of conservative domination of independent radio. Conservatives had taken advantage of changes in the radio industry in the 1950s to build an informal network of radio stations spanning the entire country. By the early 1960s, a dozen right-wing broadcasters aired on 100 or more radio stations nationwide. Several had annual incomes of more than $1 million a year. Carl McIntire had the largest media footprint, with a weekly listening audience estimated at 20 million, or 1 in 9 American households. The election of 1960 marked the first time these conservative broadcasters flexed their political muscle on a national stage. A quick look at chart figure 1.1, which counts the radio stations that aired McIntire's program, illustrates both the precipitous rise of right-wing radio and the scale of the problem confronting John F. Kennedy. As the chart indicates, McIntire's radio show, the 20th Century Reformation Hour, aired on just two stations in 1957, but by 1960, that number had swelled to more than 100 stations spread across the nation. A near exponential growth curve meant that these radio preachers were no longer just a backwoods problem. Kennedy responded to the crisis in West Virginia by forming a strategic alliance with the National Council of Churches. With 45 million members, the National Council of Churches was the largest religious organization in the United States. It had its own set of concerns regarding conservative radio preachers, detailed in Chapter 6, so it was happy to provide Kennedy with Protestant covering fire. The campaign quickly mailed a selection of pro-Kennedy quotes from National Council of Churches executives to every Protestant minister in West Virginia, encouraging them to read the endorsements aloud to their congregations in the weeks leading up to the vote. The tactic helped Kennedy win the West Virginia primary. Kennedy learned two very important lessons from the episode. First, that right-wing radio was a serious political threat. And second, that dealing with these broadcasters required cooperation with allied interest groups. Kennedy would need that kind of help again. The overriding priority of a first-term president is becoming a second-term president. Kennedy had beaten Richard Nixon in the 1960 general election by the thinnest of margins, just 118,574 votes out of the more than 68 million cast, and he expected an equally tough rematch in 1964. But while the West Virginia crisis was Kennedy's first encounter with right-wing radio, it would by no means be his last. Conservative broadcasting continued to grow during Kennedy's term in office. By 1964, Carl McIntire's program had quadrupled its station count to 480 stations. The threat of right-wing radio had metastasized from a West Virginia problem in 1960 to a national problem by 1964, a situation drawn in sharp relief by maps which show the radio stations airing McIntire's program during those 2 years. These maps are of interest not only for the sheer number of stations dotting the country, and McIntire had at least one station in all 50 states, though never all at the same time, but also for where they were concentrated. Of McIntire's 480 stations in 1964, over half, or 262, were in the South. This New Jersey preacher had built a massive audience below the Mason-Dixon line. Indeed, there was a strong correlation between those states with the densest per capita concentrations of right-wing radio stations, like South Carolina, Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, and Louisiana, and those states that voted for Republican presidential candidate Barry Goldwater in 1964. To the modern eye, the maps may not seem surprising, given half a century of Republican domination in presidential elections in the southern states. But the transition from a solidly blue Democratic South to a solidly red Republican South was still in its infancy in the early 1960s. Traditionally, historians have credited that transition first to Barry Goldwater in 1964, and then to Richard Nixon and campaign advisor Kevin Phillips in 1968 and 1972. Theirs was a Republican Southern strategy designed to woo disaffected Southern Democrats angry over their party's support for desegregation. Yet, as this map suggests, the contours of the Southern strategy were laid down years in advance of either candidate. Right-wing broadcasters prepared the way for the rise of the Republican South. President Kennedy knew that these broadcasters posed a serious and growing threat both to his legislative goals and to his hopes of re-election in 1964. Within weeks of his inauguration, the administration had already begun planning for his re-election campaign. Robert F. Kennedy, the new U.S. Attorney General and the president's brother, met with labor union leaders Walter and Victor Reuther multiple times in 1961 to discuss campaign strategy. Robert Kennedy tasked the Reuther brothers with a special mission: find a way to undermine the threat posed by this new political force that had come seemingly out of nowhere, the extreme right wing. By the end of 1961, the Reuthers hand-delivered a 24-page document titled The Radical Right in America Today, colloquially known as the Reuther Memorandum. The memorandum warned that right-wing radicals were better organized than at any time in recent history, were still growing in strength, and were springing up like weeds all over the country. The Reuthers identified some of the usual conservative suspects, including the stridently anti-communist John Birch Society, but the focus of the memorandum was on right-wing broadcasters. The Reuther memorandum noted these broadcasters' ability to rouse vicious local pressure campaigns against teachers or preachers or anyone else who supports anything from negotiation in foreign affairs to governmental programs in domestic affairs. Furthermore, their pressure tactics on already timid congressmen were already having an effect on the administration's legislative agenda. an extreme threat justified an extreme response. The Ruther brothers encouraged the Kennedy brothers to use every weapon in the executive arsenal, both licit and not, to silence conservative broadcasting. As this audiobook details, the Kennedy White House would implement each of the major planks of the Ruther plan, using the Internal Revenue Service to target conservative broadcasters with audits, and the Federal Communications Commission, FCC, to selectively enforce regulations for radio stations airing right-wing programs. After John F. Kennedy's assassination, the Democratic National Committee picked up the baton and used similar tactics to harass Goldwater supporters in the summer of 1964. Other allied liberal interest groups, including the National Council of Churches, would join the effort in the second half of the 1960s. By the end of the decade, conservative broadcasting was a shell of its former self. The Kennedys' implementation of the Ruther Memorandum slowed the advance of modern conservatism for the better part of a decade. This was the most successful episode of government censorship in America of the past half century. One might think that so egregious an abuse of executive power, with such far-reaching political consequences, would attract the attention of historians of the new right. It generally has not. For example, Jonathan Schoenwald only mentions that the Kennedy administration at least considered using right-wing groups as a political tool to help carry the 1964 elections, but he fails to note that the administration went way beyond merely considering action. The single best work on conservative broadcasting in the 1960s, by media studies scholar Heather Hendershot, dedicates full chapters to several of the major broadcasters and takes seriously their role in the rise of the new right. Yet even Hendershot's groundbreaking work only teases the extent of the opposition to conservative broadcasting from the Kennedy administration, the Democratic National Committee, and other interest groups. This historiographical oversight may be a function of how the story upends our assumptions about the natural positions for the right and the left in the drama of American political culture. Scholarly accounts of censorship in modern American history usually feature the suppression of left-wing groups by right-wing politicians, preachers, and businessmen, intent on preserving their power and privilege. So it is surprising when the roles are reversed, when conservatives are no longer censors, but the censored. Historians may not be as attuned to stories that cut against the expected narrative. Yet, understanding the censorship of conservative broadcasters in the 1960s can help scholars historicize the sense of grievance that still persists on the right today about the perceived liberal domination of the mainstream media. That sense of grievance is a major theme in historian Nicole Hemmer's recently published book, Messengers of the Right. Hemmer's main character is broadcaster Clarence Manion, who plays only a supporting role in this audiobook, and she pays greater attention to Manion's publishing endeavors than she does to his radio program. Where Messengers of the Right and this audiobook diverge is in regard to the counter-radio right campaign. It is almost entirely beyond Hemmer's scope. Indeed, she implies that what she calls the censorship angle, or accusations of the targeted use of the FCC's fairness doctrine against conservative broadcasters, was mostly a figment of overactive imaginations. According to Hemmer, conservative broadcasters had mistaken simple regulatory ambiguity for a conspiracy. Yet, as this audiobook shows, there was indeed a concerted campaign to mute the radio right using federal regulatory power. This was no mere angle. It resulted in a precipitous decline in right-wing broadcasting during the late 1960s. If one criterion of a movement's importance is the lengths to which its opponents will go to stop it, then conservative broadcasting had been paid the ultimate backhanded compliment. At its core, this audiobook is an exploration of the importance of the radio right through the eyes of its opponents. Historians should take notice of how often contemporary critics of the new right readily acknowledged conservative broadcasters' growing political power in their private correspondence and internal memoranda. Critics of the nascent new right often dismissed these conservatives as extremists, radicals, and nuts. But the Kennedy administration believed they posed a threat serious enough to warrant major executive action. Taking account of the Kennedy administration's counter-radio right censorship campaign ought to change how historians interpret the arc of his presidency. The first accounts of the administration were written by sympathetic journalists and former staffers. who naturally emphasized Kennedy's positive accomplishments. But as a result of the sprawling investigations into the Nixon administration a decade later, scholars received access to previously classified information about the administration's more unsavory actions. Looking back through the lens of the Watergate scandal cast the Kennedy administration in a very different light for revisionist historians in the 1970s and 1980s. A motif in their work was the willingness of the president and the attorney general to bend the rules for political advantage. For example, most revisionist accounts of the Kennedy administration mentioned his fight with the steel industry in 1962, during which the president and attorney general used subpoenas, midnight Federal Bureau of Investigation, FBI interviews, and an antitrust investigation to intimidate recalcitrant executives and skeptical journalists. The ends justified the means, since, in President Kennedy's own words, "They fucked us. We've got to try to fuck them." Since the first wave of revisionist work, historians have continued to uncover other questionable executive actions, including targeted Internal Revenue Service, IRS audits, and warrantless wiretapping of mobsters, labor union leaders, and civil rights activists. In 1971, journalist Victor Navasky described this pattern of behavior as an authoritarian capability. In the harsh afterglow of the Pentagon Papers and Watergate scandals, it was easy to see a precedent in the Kennedy administration's willingness to brush aside norms and laws, as it did with its Get Hoffa squad. Nobody shed a tear for an organized crime figure like Jimmy Hoffa, but Navasky worried that future administrations might be willing to use those same tools to go after other groups, like a Get Panther squad, or a Get Radical Liberal squad, or a Get Birchers squad. Given later revelations about the FBI's COINTELPRO campaign against the Black Panthers, as well as the Kennedy administration's anti-radio right efforts, Navasky was more accurate in his apprehensions than he could possibly have known at the time. As one biographer later noted, while discussing the Kennedy administration's misuse of the IRS. Luckily for the Kennedys, Richard Nixon's later bid to politicize the IRS was egregious enough that when Congress got around to investigating, it focused mostly on Republican abuses and less on Bobbies. But by the 1990s, a wave of post-revisionist scholars took a more nuanced approach, acknowledging the administration's excesses while emphasizing personal and political growth over the course of Kennedy's term in office. Historian Peter Ling summarized the post-revisionist vision as the belief that JFK was a man who grew towards greatness during his presidency. Kennedy was a better president in 1962 than in 1961, and showed still further promise in the summer of 1963 with the Test Ban Treaty and the Civil Rights Bill. Yet this audiobook supports a neo-revisionist understanding of the Kennedy administration. Consider one of the key events Ling cited as proof of Kennedy's personal growth: the passage of the 1963 Nuclear Test Ban Treaty. That was the proximate cause for the White House's sweeping use of executive power to silence the treaty's critics among the radio right. Inasmuch as Kennedy grew towards greatness, it included a growth in his willingness to abuse executive power in order to advance his legislative agenda. Conservative complaints about hostile treatment were invariably dismissed in the 1960s. Indeed, scholars of the time cited those very complaints as evidence of the movement's inherently conspiratorial mindset. For a time, historians followed suit, but the idea of the right as the natural home for the paranoid began with American social scientists, not historians. They, in turn, borrowed insights from post-World War II European scholars who were seeking to explain the rise of fascism. The key to understanding the right, according to mid-20th century sociologists like Daniel Bell, was to see it as fundamentally a matter of psychology. The right flourished among middle-class people who were anxious over challenges to their fragile social status. As originally framed by European scholars, such challenges were primarily economic. But with a little tweaking, it was possible for Bell to frame the rise of the American radical right, the title of an influential edited collection by Bell, as a response to the racial, sexual, and cultural transformations of American culture in the 1950s and 1960s. The conservative reaction to those changes was marked, in historian Richard Hofstadter's words, by a paranoid style of politics that saw conspiracies lurking behind every sinister development in American society and which sought an authoritarian strongman that could save the nation. The right was unified not by shared beliefs or an intellectual tradition, according to this interpretation. It was a product of psychosis, manifesting as paranoia. As historians over the past two decades have increasingly turned their attention to modern conservatism, in response to Alan Brinkley's influential call for scholars to grapple with what he labeled the orphan of political history, they widely rejected the social scientific psychologizing of the right. In part, that was a consequence of the right's endurance in American politics. It was convenient for Bell and Hofstadter to frame the right as a temporary recrudescence of America's id during a time of social upheaval. For if it was a revolt against modernity, then they could dismiss it as a political force of long-term significance. But after Ronald Reagan's election in 1980, conservatism seemed rather less temporary, and the former explanation no longer seemed quite so convincing. As historian Lisa McGurr complained, Hofstadter's excessively psychological interpretation distorted our understanding of American conservatism and retarded historical inquiry. Historians began taking conservatism seriously as a belief system, rather than as a mere facade covering up primitive neurotic impulses. Much of the growing literature on conservatism from the past 20 years can be seen as a tacit rebuttal to the old status anxiety perspective. Although historians are more inclined to take conservatism seriously as an ideological system than they were a generation ago, the historiography of the new right has a continuing "What's the matter with Kansas?" problem, to borrow the title of historian and journalist Thomas Frank's best-selling book. In the book, Frank grappled with the seeming contradiction of Republicans in small-town America voting against their economic self-interest by casting their ballots for the party of laissez-faire economics. Frank thought he had solved the riddle. Conservative elites were hoodwinking ordinary voters by distracting them with talk of culture wars, family values, and a range of social conservative issues. Make voters fear gay marriage or abortion rights, and they will vote against their pocketbook. Or so the argument went. Frank's Kansas thesis continues to be popular in contemporary political analysis. But whatever the concept's utility in the 21st century, reading it back into the history of 1960s conservatism is a mistake. Yet, some historians have done so because it allows scholars to strip conservatism of its ideological trappings. Instead, it can be reduced, in the words of historian Nancy McLean, to a commitment to safeguard the advantages of those long privileged, whether by class, race, gender, religion, or sexual orientation, while its leaders have systematically exploited fear and prejudice in order to acquire power. Yet, as Chapter 2 details, grassroots conservative activism in the early 1960s thrived in leafy suburbs filled with the families of white-collar professionals, places like Orange County, California, and Dallas, Texas. They were doctors, lawyers, housewives, and engineers, living in the economically prosperous Sun Belt, a very different group than the popular caricature of 1960s conservatives as a bunch of frustrated white laborers in the Deep South and the Midwestern Rust Belt. Certainly those voters did exist, and they played a significant role in the election of 1968, buoying the surprise candidacy of George Wallace. But they were not the core constituency of the new right earlier in the decade. Working-class Southern whites had a significant role to play in the creation of a new Republican coalition, but it is overly simplistic to reduce the entire story of the new right to their story. Even when accounting for the cross-class nature of conservatism, some historians still deny agency to grassroots activists, turning them instead into unthinking pawns of conservative elites. In that vein, Nancy McLean proposes that ordinary Americans were not in the driver's seat of this movement and had little sense of the conservative leaders' overall project, let alone their strategy for achieving it. Instead, the right was a product of organizing by conservative intellectuals and politicians who stirred anxiety about where the country was headed in order to build the power to turn national policy away from the inclusive social citizenship inaugurated in the New Deal. This is a vision of the right as a top-down, manufactured movement. While on the surface it may appear to be a genuinely grassroots social movement, it is actually a front for the interests of industrial, intellectual, and political elites. Like AstroTurf, it looks real from a distance, but up close, you can see that it is plastic. Few historians are as explicit as MacLean in denying the grassroots legitimacy of the new right. But the idea is implicit in a new body of work published in the afterglow of the 2007-2008 financial crisis. Historians like Kim Phillips Fine, Bethany Morton, Benjamin Waterhouse, and Kevin Cruz have undertaken a corporate turn in the study of the right. Each identifies specific corporate interests that funded right-wing think tanks, periodicals, and even preachers. And there were many connections between the right and the business world, even in broadcasting. One of the three most influential conservative programs of the 1960s, the Fax Forum, was solely funded by Texas oil man and millionaire H.L. Hunt, who inserted advertisements for Hunt-produced household goods in between turgid peons to the free market system. If Hunt had added a Hollywood celebrity like Ronald Reagan to his show, he would have had a knockoff version of the General Electric Theater. All that is to say, while the corporate turn has real historical value, at least some part of its popular appeal comes from the way in which readers have been primed by the financial crisis to blame America's political and economic ills on big corporations, a sentiment that is then read back into the history of the new right. Yet, this historiographical trend has minimized the contributions of grassroots activists who had little or no connection to corporate interests. Framing the entire new right as a corporate creation is a mistake. As we will hear, Chapter 2 describes a national boycott of Eastern European imports led by suburban housewives, who would have taken offense at being called simple-minded dupes. And even among broadcasters, H.L. Hunt's corporate financing model was an outlier. A majority of the top-earning conservative programs were almost entirely financed by small listener contributions. $1 a month here, $5 a month there, adding up to annual budgets of $1 million or more per broadcaster. Conservative radio's standard fiscal model more closely resembled a national public radio pledge drive than it did a corporate front. Again, as with the Reuther Memorandum, it can be instructive to consider what the new right's most trenchant opponents thought of the movement. The Kennedy administration did target conservative leaders, particularly broadcasters, but that was precisely because of those broadcasters' ability to harness authentic, grassroots outrage and direct it at the administration. The Kennedys and Reuthers respected the irritating resourcefulness of the conservative grassroots. Historians should follow their lead. Yet, if the rise of modern conservatism was neither propelled by a primal sense of status anxiety, nor merely a product of corporate interests, then what can explain why growing numbers of ordinary conservatives began to engage in grassroots activism during the early 1960s? Historians have assumed that figuring out the origins of the new right requires identifying which issue, or set of issues, opposition to civil rights, feminism, abortion, secularization of education, and so on, activated conservative outrage and stimulated social movement formation. But there is no sui generis idea or issue to which we can link the rise of the right. Simply put, the answer to the question, where did the right come from, depends on whom and when historians focus their attention. However, there is a theme that unites all such answers. Each explains the rise of conservatism by pointing to a shift in the demand for conservative ideas, making outrage over new social or political developments the key to understanding how potential conservatives became actual conservatives. A housewife, previously apathetic about politics, finds a sex education book in her child's backpack and then runs for a seat on the school board. A small-town businessman opens the newspaper to read about the Supreme Court's decision in Roe v. Wade and decides to donate money to a pro-life organization. Framed this way, exposure to a cultural transformation, in this example, the sexual revolution and reproductive rights, alienated a group of people. That sense of alienation created a demand for conservative alternatives, something to explain what went wrong in America and what could be done to fix it. The most highly motivated of these new conservative converts were then willing to engage in political activism. This framework leaves historians to ask which hot-button issues were most effective at stimulating conservative outrage and activism. The hunt for the correct issue has led to internecine historiographical squabbles over which issue was most important or most pervasive. This is not to suggest that demand-side explanations of the rise of the right do not have value. Conservatives did indeed respond to the sexual revolution, the spread of communism, the civil rights movement, and a host of other cultural developments in the mid-20th century. The problem is that the other half of the equation, the supply of conservative ideas, has been neglected because of the fixation on demand. Ideas do not just float through the ether like spores infecting human hosts in an ideological invasion of the body snatchers. Someone using a mode of distribution must transmit ideas to those people who might be interested. Prior to the 20th century, ideas spread primarily via print in the form of cheaply printed pamphlets, newspapers, and books, each copy of which might reach dozens or even hundreds of readers. The advent of radio exponentially expanded distribution networks. Each radio broadcast could reach thousands or even millions of listeners, none of whom needed to be literate to understand the message. Radio made ideas cheaper to distribute and more broadly accessible. It did not take long for ideologues and politicians to grasp the inherent advantages of the medium. Huey Long and Father Charles Coughlin used the radio to build grassroots progressive movements in the 1930s. President Franklin Delano Roosevelt used his radio fireside chats to bolster popular support for the New Deal. Understanding the surge of progressive sentiment in the 1930s means paying attention not only to external developments like the Great Depression, but also to the ways in which a new technology allowed the efficient distribution of progressive solutions for those problems. The ability to supply progressive ideas had as important a role to play in the politics of the 1930s as changes in the demand for those same ideas. Similarly, the history of conservative broadcasting in the late 1950s and 1960s has broad implications for how we conceptualize the rise of the new right. As the major radio networks shifted their attention and investment capital to the new medium of television, radio increasingly became the preserve of small independent stations that could not afford to be as picky about their programming as the networks had been. Radio broadcasting was newly affordable, and niche political groups were suddenly able to buy time slots on stations all across the country. Conservative broadcasting was utterly transformed. In the early 1950s, not a single non-network conservative broadcaster aired on more than a handful of stations. Within a decade, a dozen conservative broadcasters aired on 100 or more independent stations nationwide, most on a daily basis. Conservative ideas could now be instantly disseminated across the country to millions of listeners, and broadcasters were not just transmitting ideas, but also issuing calls to action. With the encouragement of conservative broadcasters, a wave of grassroots activism swept the nation in the late 1950s and early 1960s. In one such instance in 1962, a local Miami boycott of goods imported from communist Eastern Europe spread to 260 cities in 48 states, ultimately forcing Congress to tinker with the Kennedy administration's trade policy and causing consternation in the White House. Actions like the boycott were the stuff from which the modern conservative movement was created, and it could happen thanks to the suddenly pervasive presence of conservative broadcasters. The tide of conservative sentiment that reached its 1960s high water mark with Barry Goldwater's presidential campaign had ridden a wave of right-wing broadcasting. Parallel to how the boom in conservative broadcasting explains the rise of the new right at the turn of the 1960s, the censorship campaign to suppress those same broadcasters helps explain the temporary decline of conservatism during the late 1960s. The standard explanation for conservative setbacks after 1964 is that Goldwater's landslide defeat by Lyndon Johnson in 1964 embarrassed the conservative faction of the Republican Party and empowered the moderate faction, which then backed a moderate Richard Nixon in 1968 and 1972. As Donald Crichlow put it, the election of 1964 returned the GOP right to the fringes of the party. It was not until the elections of 1976 and 1980 that conservatives would reemerge from their self-imposed exile and vote for Ronald Reagan. Call this the demoralization thesis of the decline of the new right. There are alternative explanations for the decline of conservative influence in national politics from 1965 to 1976. On the one hand, historians with an eye on the grassroots have shown that conservative activism never truly ceased during this period. The anti-abortion movement continued to bubble just below the surface. Ronald Reagan was still the popular governor of California, and activists like Phyllis Schlafly were not sitting home twiddling their thumbs. That said, it is true that conservatives were not as visible on the national stage in the late 1960s as they had been earlier in the decade. Conservatism had indeed taken a step back, but it was not a sense of demoralization that had caused it. By 1964 and 1965, the counter-conservative broadcasting campaign had begun to take effect. As a result of targeted regulatory attacks, radio stations started dropping conservative programming en masse. Since those programs played such an important role in energizing grassroots activism, it is not surprising that the movement faltered as conservative broadcasting faltered. That was precisely the original intent of the plan concocted by the Kennedys and Ruthers in 1961. The fortunes of grassroots conservatism and right-wing broadcasting were tightly intertwined. Both would falter in the late 1960s, but both would also see a resurgence in the late 1970s with the relaxation of radio and television broadcasting rules, as well as the rise of cable broadcasting. Focusing on the role of conservative broadcasting also re-centers the contributions of radical voices on the right, and in so doing, challenges the self-propagated origins myth of modern conservatism. Typically, there are two individuals that historians of the New Right choose as a point of departure: Barry Goldwater or William F. Buckley, Jr. Thus, Arizona Senator and 1964 Republican nominee Barry Goldwater is called a towering figure, and his campaign described as the Woodstock of American conservatism, presumably with fewer drugs, less sex, and much worse music. Before Goldwater, or so the story goes, conservatism was a mess, divided into a confusing patchwork of small organizations without clear goals or a sense of broader purpose. At least, that is, until the senator taught millions of Americans how and why they were conservative Republicans and planted the seeds for the future growth of conservative agitation. Goldwater's 1964 campaign was undeniably a major turning point in the history of the New Right, training a future generation of conservative political operatives and boosting conservative influence in the Republican Party. However, Goldwater was a product of the grassroots New Right, not its progenitor. Years before he discovered his conscience, hundreds of thousands of ordinary conservatives were already engaged in substantial, effective political activism. Indeed, it is not incidental that a conservative broadcaster, Clarence Manion, recruited Goldwater to run for president, assembled his campaign contribution team, convinced a skeptical William F. Buckley to support his candidacy, and arranged for the writing and publication of Goldwater's best-selling autobiography. The order of operations is exactly backward when we start with Goldwater. If Goldwater has been anointed the standard-bearer of the New Right, then William F. Buckley has been framed as the prophet preparing the way in the conservative intellectual wilderness of the 1950s. The defeat of conservative Senator Robert Taft by the moderate candidate Dwight D. Eisenhower in the 1952 Republican primaries had left conservatives on the outside of party power, looking in. During this fallow time, or so the story goes, Buckley made conservatism relevant once again by blending elements of classical liberalism with Cold War interventionism and Catholic social conservatism. He and a handful of other like-minded contrarian intellectuals made this fusionist conservatism a respectable mainstream ideology. Then, in the mid-1960s, when disreputable fellow travelers like the John Birch Society and extremist broadcasters threatened to return conservatism to the political margins through their outlandish conspiracy theories and uncouth rhetoric, Buckley saved the conservative movement by turning his pen against the radicals and purging them from the masthead of his magazine, the National Review. By this account, Buckley is the beating heart of the conservative movement, both founder and protector, and his National Review is called the ur-text of modern conservatism. In the magazine's first issue, Buckley declared that conservatism stands athwart history, yelling stop. The problem is that historians have looked to Buckley and done precisely that. Buckley and his ideological descendants have actively promoted this Buckley-centric narrative of the rise of the new right. Perhaps the most frequently cited book on the topic is George H. Nash's The Conservative Intellectual Movement in America Since 1945. For Nash, the conservative movement was a movement of ideas, and the men, and it is very much a gentleman's club, who came up with the ideas, are the heroes of the tale. These purveyors of ideas were the architects of the right. On the other hand, there were those engaged in the hurly-burly of everyday politics. These extremists of the right may have been energetic, but their contribution to conservatism as an intellectual force was negligible. Ideas were what mattered, not action. Nash's emphasis is very much in keeping with Buckley's own point of view. He founded National Review to influence the opinion makers of the nation, not to bother with any popular and cliché-ridden appeal to the grassroots. For both Nash and Buckley, it was intellectuals who midwived and implemented the revolution, not those mindlessly energetic, non-intellectual grassroots types, or the radio broadcasters who enabled their activism. Buckley's marginalization of the radicals has had a long half-life because it is politically convenient. On the one hand, that framing allowed Buckley to paint his own branch of conservatism as, to quote Heather Hendershot, conservative, but not extremist. Never mind that on issues of policy substance, Buckley and the broadcasters were in lockstep agreement. Rick Perlstein, in a widely read mea culpa after the 2016 election, acknowledged that political historians had bought into this respectability narrative. After all, they were writing about the modern conservative movement, the one that led to Reagan, not about the brutish relics of a more gothic, ill-formed, and supposedly incoherent reactionary era that preceded it. For Perlstein, telling that respectable tale meant ignoring the conspiracy-mongering and racist constituent mail that poured into congressional offices during the 1960s. Yet, conservative broadcasters constantly encouraged their listeners to join letter-writing campaigns and promoted conspiratorial understandings of current events. Studying the radio right in the 1960s is an antidote to that kind of historiographical oversight. Whatever the reason, it has been easy to exaggerate Buckley's importance because he was, in a sense, the last man standing. The National Review remains an influential conservative magazine today. None of the major 1960s conservative radio programs still exist, and most were in serious decline by the 1970s. Yet, persistence is only one measure of significance, and arguably not the most important, given the context. The Kennedy administration decided that conservative broadcasters were a more serious threat than the publishers, and then successfully undermined that threat using executive power. Surely that suggests the inverse of the Buckley narrative, that it was extremist broadcasters who were the more important factor in the formation of the 1960s right, important enough to attract the kind of adverse regulatory attention that Buckley himself was spared. As Jonathan Schoenwald has argued, the radicals acted as a buffer for the responsible right, deflecting criticism that might have otherwise focused on the hardcore of the GOP. Schoenwald is right, though conservative broadcasters faced much more than mere criticism. The Buckley-centric analysis of the conservative movement is fundamentally flawed in another way. Ideas do matter, but they do not spread themselves. The Buckley-Nash explanation for the rise of the right lacks a convincing means of distribution. The closest they come is to point to the National Review, giving the magazine a great deal of explanatory freight. As conservative journalist George Will would later say, "Without Buckley, no National Review. Without National Review, no conservative takeover of the Republican Party. Without that, no Reagan. Without Reagan, no victory in the Cold War." By the transitive power, Buckley had personally won the Cold War. But while the National Review had nearly 73,000 subscribers by 1964, a single conservative radio program, Carl McIntire's 20th Century Reformation Hour, had a listening audience estimated at 20 million. It is true that conservative broadcasters mostly repackaged ideas borrowed from elsewhere, including from Buckley. But it was they who provided the crucial link between rarefied publications like the National Review and millions of ordinary activists. Buckley might have been the architect of the new right, but broadcasters were the construction company that hired the workers and assembled the structure. It is long past time to place the radicals back at the center of the rise of the new right. Although the actions of the Ruthers, the Kennedys, and the Democratic National Committee lie at the core of this audiobook, it is also a political history of religious broadcasting. The two featured broadcasters, Carl McIntire and Billy James Hargis, were fundamentalist preachers in addition to being conservative activists. The political and religious aspects of their public personas cannot be disentangled. While they were part of a movement that upended the post-World War II party system, they also represented a challenge to the informal religious establishment of the mid-20th century that was institutionalized in the National Council of Churches. The National Council of Churches was an ecumenical church council that represented some 45 million American Protestants. Its leadership tended to be both theologically and politically progressive, and they shared every bit of the Kennedy administration's distaste for conservative fundamentalist broadcasters like Billy James Hargis and Carl McIntire. Indeed, after the Democratic National Committee stopped its direct involvement in the counter-conservative broadcasting campaign in 1965, the National Council of Churches picked up where the Democratic National Committee left off. The National Council of Churches was not directly responsible for the changes in the regulatory environment. Those can be traced back to the Kennedy administration. But the council would take advantage of those changes to undermine its religious competitors. The informal mainline religious establishment leveraged its political connections to hobble competing religious groups, even while claiming to be champions of religious toleration. In speaking of religion and the new right, there is a final point of terminology to be made. Many scholars studying the role of religion in the rise of conservatism have adopted the phrases new Christian right or religious right to mark the movement off from the rest of a presumably secular right. Yet the terms only entered common usage after Newsweek magazine announced that 1976 was the year of the evangelical because of evangelical support for Jimmy Carter. Whether or not the phrases new Christian right and religious right have utility for explaining the political landscape in the late 1970s and 1980s is a matter for another audiobook. But historians are imposing an alien category when we read that phrase back into the 1960s. This is a mistake also because, as Darren Dochuk has noted, doing so has helped reify the popular notion that evangelicalism affects the political arena only haphazardly and episodically in contexts of crisis, like a jack-in-the-box popping out simply to provide scholars with a colorful anecdote. Ironically, evangelicals themselves had a hand in walling off the new Christian right from the new right proper. Evangelical scholar James Davison Hunter identified three waves of evangelical political activism in the 1920s, the early 1950s, and finally the 1980s, that he treated as discrete phenomena from the rest of the conservative movement. Yet Hunter portrayed the late 1950s and 1960s, the period when the rise of the new right began, as a time when theologically conservative Protestants were almost uniformly politically quietistic. This would have been a revelation to religious broadcasters like Carl McIntire, Frederick Schwartz, Billy James Hargis, Fulton Lewis, and their millions of listeners. Even those right-wingers who were not known for their personal religiosity, like Robert Welch, routinely appealed to religious supporters, which in Welch's case meant naming the John Birch Society after an actual missionary killed in China by communist forces during World War II. Scratch the surface of any right-wing archive from the 1960s, and religion oozes out. This audiobook is a political history of religious broadcasting, a social history of grassroots conservatism, a media history of mid-20th century radio, and a prehistory of the Reagan Revolution. The radio right created a national grassroots movement, forced the White House to listen to housewives who were angry about Polish ham, started the partisan transformation of the Deep South years before the Republican Party thought to try doing so itself, provoked the most intense episode of government censorship of the past half century, undermined the largest religious organization in America, and launched the first wave of mass right-wing radio. In sum, it is the story of how conservative radio left a lasting mark on America in the 1960s, to 1970s. 2. Polish Ham and the Southern Strategy. How the Radio Right Created a Conservative Social Movement. Modern observers may take for granted that talk radio is the natural preserve of conservatism. It has been linked to each of the major conservative movements of the past four decades, from the Reagan Revolution in 1980 to the Tea Party movement in 2009. We've become used to a political landscape in which conservative radio broadcasters have the ability to shape the national political conversation in decisive ways. But such was not always the case. Conservative dominance on independent radio was a radically new development in the 1960s, enabling the creation of a new conservative grassroots that wielded a stunning amount of political influence, given the relative youth of the movement. The radio right used that influence on behalf of conservatives who felt overlooked by the media and alienated from the federal government. Broadcasters encouraged grassroots activism, including a nearly forgotten boycott of imported Polish ham by suburban housewives, which ultimately forced Congress to defy the Kennedy administration on trade policy. Of even more lasting impact than the boycott was the way that broadcasters aided the partisan transformation of the Deep South by appealing to segregationists. The radio right helped turn traditional Southern Democrats into Republicans, making the Republican Party the party of white, massive resistance. This rise of mass right-wing radio was only possible because of a dramatic shift in the radio industry in the mid-1950s. Previously, almost all radio stations were affiliated with large radio networks like CBS and NBC. The networks produced national programming that they then distributed to their local affiliates for a fee. They also had the right to up or down approval over local programming decisions. Anything that was too politically, culturally, or religiously controversial was banned. That policy marginalized radical political voices on both the left and the right during the first three decades of mass radio, including anti-New Deal populists like Father Charles Coughlin, socialist labor unions, and the National Association of Evangelicals. But in the 1950s, the radio landscape changed as the network switched their focus from radio to television, pouring investment capital into the new technology, and leaving radio to smaller entrepreneurs. Yet, at the same moment, the number of AM stations in America nearly quadrupled, from about 900 in 1945 to 3,500 in 1960. Almost all of that boom was composed of independent, non-network owners, many of whom owned a single station apiece. In 1945, the four major networks controlled 95% of all radio stations in America. Just 7 years later, that percentage had plummeted to less than half, with the percentage continuing to fall throughout the 1950s. Not only did networks stop applying for new radio station licenses, but also, they stopped working as hard to sell radio advertising spots. More stations, with fewer advertising dollars sloshing around, meant that the new small-time, small-town stations had tight monthly budgets. They could not afford to be as picky about programming as the big networks had been in the past. While station owners were not necessarily a politically minded lot, they aired an increasing number of overtly political programs from a wide variety of ideological points of view. This presented formerly niche political groups with the opportunity to cobble together hundreds of independent stations into informal syndicated networks for their radio shows. Stations constantly dropped and added the programs as their budgets required, but the total number of stations airing conservative programming rose at a rapid pace. By the early 1960s, conservative listeners could turn their radio dial to any of a dozen conservative radio programs that aired on at least 100 stations nationwide. The conservative broadcasters who benefited from the transformation of the radio industry came from a wide variety of backgrounds, like Robert Welch, candy manufacturer, Clarence Manion, Catholic law professor, H. L. Hunt, Texas oil magnate, and Billy James Hargis and Carl McIntire, fundamentalist preachers. Each had their own particular style, but they all shared a set of conservative priorities, rolling back the New Deal state and taking an aggressive stance against global communism. Carl McIntire in particular was representative of a group of ordained ministers who took to the airwaves. His radio show, the 20th Century Reformation Hour, began broadcasting from Collingswood, New Jersey in 1955. He claimed that communists lurked behind every sinister development in American society, from nuclear disarmament to sex education. McIntire stoked these fears to a paranoid degree. Note the title of one of McIntire's revival meeting brochures, Stalin's Agents in Camden County. But beneath his anti-communist rhetoric was an authentic expression of growing conservative dissent from consensus liberalism. The Eisenhower, Kennedy, and Johnson administrations' support for desegregation, internationalism, and the expansion of the federal government deeply unsettled ordinary conservatives. Since they felt they could not trust the broadcast networks to tell the truth, conservative distrust of the mainstream media is not a recent phenomenon. They tuned instead into the 20th Century Reformation Hour and dozens of similar programs for the real scoop on the news. The most complete, extant archives of any of the 1960s conservative broadcasters belongs to McIntire, in part because his papers were seized along with his office for non-payment of taxes in the 1990s. Neither McIntire's family nor his friends had the chance to edit out his embarrassing correspondence or throw away seemingly unimportant financial documents. Given the relative completeness of McIntire's records, it is possible to reconstruct the boom in conservative broadcasting during the late 1950s and early 1960s in remarkable detail. This, not anti-communism or any other issue of the day, is what explains the rise of the new right. In 1957, McIntire's radio show aired on just two stations, but by 1964, that number had swelled to 480. To put those numbers in political context, McIntire's station count more than doubled during John F. Kennedy's time in the White House. McIntire was the largest single conservative broadcaster in the early 1960s, but other broadcasters saw parallel increases in station counts. Billy James Hargis had gone from a single station in Oklahoma in the early 1950s to 68 stations in 1960 and 200 stations in 1962, with an additional 20 television stations. Clarence Manion had started with 29 stations in 1954, but was up to more than 200 stations in 41 states by 1961. Starting in 1958, oil millionaire H.L. Hunt, seeking to both dodge taxes and fight communism, plunked his program on 300 radio and 50 television stations. These bare station totals are impressive, but seeing a program like McIntire's mapped gives an even clearer sense of the national reach conservative broadcasting had. Each of the dots in Figure 2.1 indicates a station that aired McIntire during the Polish ham boycott. You would have to add another 150 dots to that map to portray McIntire at his peak in 1964. But even in 1962, his message of support for the boycott had the potential to reach a majority of American listeners. Prior to the late 1950s, conservative ideas were transmitted primarily through print. Once a week or once a month, you would receive a newspaper from your favorite conservative outlet. Carl McIntire himself had a periodical for two decades before he started his regular radio show. It was called the Christian Beacon, a weekly newspaper with a circulation of roughly 20,000 in the late 1950s. For the sake of comparison, the National Review, William F. Buckley's more famous magazine targeting a higher brow audience, reached 18,000 at the time, though subscriptions would grow in the 1960s. Those who subscribed to the Christian Beacon or the National Review were a dedicated core group, but there were strict upper limits to the numbers of people willing to pay for a newspaper subscription, and the total audience was constrained by their reliance on word-of-mouth distribution. Adding together the circulation figures for every major right-wing publication in 1956, no more than 310,000 individuals participated in the print network that distributed conservative ideas. And that figure rests on the implausible assumption of no overlap between subscribers to different publications. That is not an inconsiderable number, but it pales next to the audience potential of radio. Indeed, it was only once conservative radio boomed in the 1960s that print circulation numbers followed. By contrast, at its peak, McIntire's radio show had a listenership of 20 million, or 1,000 times as many people as subscribed to his newspaper. Given that the population of the United States at the time was close to 180 million, that would mean that 1 in 9 Americans tuned into the 20th Century Reformation Hour. Besides the cost of a radio set, which nearly every American household already owned, listening was free. There were no subscription fees. Radio exponentially expanded the ability of conservatives to distribute their ideas to a mass audience by making it cheap, easy, and safe to consume those ideas. You did not have to be a committed conservative activist to turn the radio dial to a conservative program. You could do it in the convenience of your own home.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.